Well, as we come to the preaching of God's word this morning, if you'd like to open your Bibles to Psalm 42, I want to read for you this morning Psalm 42, verses 9 to 11, and then we'll take our lead from verse 11 in particular as we come to the preaching of God's word this morning. These are the words of David in this psalm, the word of God unto us. I say to God, my rock, why have you forgotten me? Why do I go mourning because of the oppression of the enemy? As with a deadly wound in my bones, my adversaries taunt me, while they say to me all the day long, where is your God? Why are you cast down, O my soul? And why are you in turmoil within me? Hope in God, for I shall again praise him, my salvation and my God. Amen. Thus saith the Lord. Let's call upon the Lord again as we ask his blessing upon his preached word. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the great privilege to come to the ordinances that you have appointed for the upbuilding of your church. It is a mercy, O God, to come to the means of grace this morning, to come to the preaching of your holy word. Were it not for your spirit and your wonderful providence, O Lord, we could be in many places right now around the world doing our own thing. But, O God, we bless you that you have awakened us to our need for Christ, that you have brought us unto your Son, in whom we have found salvation and eternal life, and who is our heart's joy and greatest love. We bless you, Father, that we delight in the preached word, that we long for the proclamation and the heralding of truth. And this morning, as we come as your people unto the preaching of your word, we pray that you would speak to us by the power of your Spirit. Let not the word go forth this morning to a single ear without the power of your Holy Spirit working in that heart, bringing these words to bear upon conscience and heart and mind, bringing your word to bear in the life of everyone, that those who know you may be drawn near and encouraged, and those who do not yet know you may be redeemed. Even on this very day, their souls may be saved, their hearts changed, and their whole life transformed. Bless, O God, be the God of our salvation, the God of our upbuilding, the God of grace and strength. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, as we think this morning, we cannot help but think about suffering and trial and affliction. It's a well-known fact that one of the factors that makes suffering or affliction difficult or even unbearable is its duration. We can endure almost any suffering as long as it doesn't drag on. Think of a debilitating migraine. It's bearable as long as it's gone before bedtime. We can accept almost any excruciating pain as long as the doctor will see us in the morning. Even the pangs of sudden poverty or homelessness could be quietly endured as long as we could see the light at the end of the tunnel, as long as we knew this wasn't our lot, but that it was only for a short season. And even for us as believers, in whom God daily works the grace of patience, it's the length of suffering that makes it so hard. We see this in the Psalms often, don't we? In Psalm 13, for instance, David's heart cry to the Lord is, how long, O Lord? In fact, he mentions it four times in the opening two verses. He says, how long, O Lord, will you forget me forever? How long will you hide your face from me? How long must I take counsel in my soul and have sorrow in my heart all the day? How long shall my enemy be exalted over me? Consider and answer me, O Lord my God. Light up my eyes, lest I sleep the sleep of death. Do you realize it's been 4 weeks since we've been together in worship? This is the fourth Lord's Day of live streaming at the Presbyterian Church of Cape Cod. And only God knows how much longer it'll be. I wonder if your heart cry this morning is like mine. How long, O Lord, How long must we have sorrow in our hearts? How long must we hide our faces from each other? How long must we be absent from the assembly? Our souls long, yes, faint, for the courts of the Lord. How lovely is your house of worship, O Lord of hosts, for a day in your courts is better than a thousand elsewhere. Is that verse becoming more true for you these days? It is for me. There's probably something else you realize as well as I do. If we were together today, we'd be sharing the Lord's Supper, first Sunday of the month. But I want to encourage you this morning that our faith doesn't hang upon the supper of the Lord. Our faith hangs upon the Lord of the supper. I want to encourage you this morning that as precious and as sweet as the courts of the Lord are, and as dear to our hearts as the assembly is, all of these things are given to us by God to point and to direct our hearts to Christ. What a reminder this providence is unto us, that it's not the church that saves you. It's not her sacraments that save you. It's not the assembly that saves you. It's Christ. Christ alone. Christ alone, as John the Apostle said, is the Lamb of God to take away sin. Christ alone is the righteousness of God to reconcile us unto God the Father. Christ alone, in his own words, is the way, the truth, and the life. And as Peter put it so eloquently, there is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved, but the name of Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God, the Son of God, the Savior of sinners. We miss the assembly. We miss the sacrament together. We miss the fellowship with one another. But this morning, I want to encourage you to take heart that despite the things that hinder us being together in the house of God, I want to encourage you that our communion with God the Father through Christ the Son by the Holy Spirit, that communion remains unbroken. The fellowship we have with God is by faith in His Son. It's by faith in His good gospel, which directs us to Christ for salvation. And so we love the ordinances, we love the gathering, we love the courts, we love the house of God. We miss these things because God appointed them for our good. And God commanded that we gather. God commanded that we commune. He commanded that we feed our souls regularly upon the means of grace that He has appointed for us. But may this providence remind us that Jesus alone is our Savior. Indeed, we look forward to the day and we pray the day will hasten when we will be back together again and we may keep the Lord's Day in His house as a congregation in the assembly. But until then, let us not faint or grow weary, but let us hold on, trusting our God. And as I said, I don't know how much longer we'll be hemmed in by this blessed providence. But as I prayerfully considered over the last couple of weeks, the temptations that we're all facing to discouragement, not only as this providence lengthens, but as there's no telling how long it'll last, it's my heart's desire this morning to fortify your heart and to help you put up a shield of inspired truths to prevent Satan from penetrating with his temptations. It's my heart's desire today to give you what you need to ward off discouragement, our greatest temptation right now. And if you don't need this encouragement today, then I praise God. But it's not just today I'm thinking about. It's tomorrow. It's next Lord's Day, and the Lord's Day after that. So I urge you this morning to lend me your ears, that I might shore up your hearts in those places where Satan is sure to target, if not today, then soon enough. Because remember, his number one aim is to separate you from your comforts in Christ. Satan's aim, being unable to take you from Christ and to rip you from the Beloved, he would seek, if he could, by all means, to separate you from the comforts you have in Jesus Christ. And nothing does that like discouragement. Because when we're discouraged, we could be sitting before a full meal and not take a single bite. We lose our appetite. When we're discouraged, we could be looking at any number of means for recovery or for strength or for advancement. And we'll let them all lie idle and we'll do nothing because we're discouraged. We just don't have the heart for it. We don't have a mind for it. We're not in the mood. We don't have the energy. We're not motivated. Discouragement stifles us completely. And Satan knows this. And this is why he works toward our discouragement, especially in seasons like this. Because if we're discouraged, then we'll look at Christ. We'll look at the means of grace. We'll look at all of the promises in the Scripture. We'll look at all the wonderful truths. We'll hear the best of sermons. And we'll do nothing with it. We'll let it lie idle. Because we just don't have the heart for it. We just don't have it in us right now. So I bring you to this familiar passage this morning, Psalm 42. Because it teaches us several things that we need to remember right now. First of all, it teaches us, and I'll lay these three very quickly out, and then we'll get to the encouragement that flows out of these truths. So first of all, this passage teaches us that there are times in the lives of God's people when we feel cast down. David did. Job did. There are times that are dark and painful and difficult, that cause our souls to pant and thirst after God, that cause our tears to be our food day and night, while they say to us all the day long, "Where is your God?" Maybe you've been asked that question recently, or maybe you've been asking it. This passage teaches us that these times can create such a turmoil in our hearts that it puts us in knots, it besets us with grief. And it causes us to say to God, "Why have you forgotten me? Why do I go about mourning all the day long?" Maybe you feel forgotten today. Maybe you've been mourning over a lost loved one, a lost income, a lost comfort. But thirdly, this passage also teaches us that there is an answer. That whatever our grief, whatever our condition, there is a remedy. Because our hope is in God, a God who is a God of faithfulness, a God of wisdom, a God of love, a God of righteousness, and most precious of all, who is our God. And this is what David preaches to himself. This is what the psalmist says to himself. Hope in God. He is our hope. He is our salvation. He is our praise, and it's because He is that we don't need to get stuck behind the dark clouds of any suffering. We don't need to carry on as those who grope for the wall in darkness. We don't need to be hypnotized by the pressures that press for our reaction, that call for our fear, or that lobby our unbelief. Because we have a God who cares for us. That's what we learn here. In Psalm 42, Psalm 43, this is the answer. The cry of the psalmist, the remedy of the psalmist, the response of the heart is it doesn't matter what's going on around me. Hope in God, because He remains my salvation. He remains my praise. He remains my trust. He is still my rock. We have a Savior who reigns over us. We have a Father who loves us. We have a Comforter who never leaves us nor forsakes us. We have an answer. Indeed, we have the answer, the only answer. Hope in God. Praise Him, for He is our salvation. He is our God. Now, there may come times when you seriously doubt those things. And maybe that time is now. When you think your condition is so dark, so painful, so desperate that you have no reason to hope in God, that you have no reason to praise God, that you have no reason to find comfort in His salvation. A time when you've lost all hope. A time when you've lost the heart to sing praise to God. When you've lost the joy of knowing that God, your God, is in control of the world because you've begun to doubt that He's doing you good. And that's why I want to give you this morning several fortifying truths to bolster your faith and to fortify you against the temptations of the enemy, which are so powerful in difficult providences like the one we're in. Now, as many of you know, I'm teaching an officer's training class on Saturdays right now, thanks to Zoom. One of the books I've assigned the men is a book of 13 excellent sermons by William Bridge on Psalm 42, verse 11. Sermons designed to ward off discouragement. And so what I'd like to do this morning is I'd like to share some of that excellence with you because I know how much it blessed me, and I believe it'll bless you as well. So let me give you these truths this morning. Seven truths to fortify our faith in times of suffering. And the first is this. You have no reason to be discouraged today because whatever your condition, God is your God still. If you could tell me what you're going through right now, I might have to agree with you that you're in a very difficult and painful strait. I might have to agree with you that few are going through what you're going through. I might have to agree with you that your cross is very heavy and your loss is grievous. But you would have to agree with me that despite your living hell, God is still your God. You would have to agree with me that nothing can cause those promises to fail. I will never leave you nor forsake you. Fear not, for I am with you and will bless you. Behold, I am with you and will keep you wherever you go. For I will not leave you until I have done what I have promised you. And what is that promise? But to bring you to glory. What this means, my dear friend, is that your troubles may darken the light of God's face for a time, but they can never put that light out. Your troubles can never snuff out the fire that burns eternally in the heart of God for you. A fiery love that sent His Son to purchase your salvation and to secure your temporal and eternal good. So here's one of your greatest truths against discouragement this morning. That God is your God. And if no condition, no providence, no trial, no suffering, no living hell, if no living hell can annul that reality, then you need to see that you don't let any condition whatsoever lead you to question that reality. Because conditions will change from one day to the next. But the word of the Lord endures forever, and this is His word to you today and always. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come into His presence with singing. Know that the Lord, He is God. It is He who made us, and we are His. We are His people and the sheep of His pasture. Enter His gates with thanksgiving and His courts with praise. Give thanks to Him. Bless His name, for the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever, and His faithfulness to all generations. You've got no reason to be discouraged today because God is your God still. Secondly, this morning, you have no reason to be discouraged today because whatever your condition, God knows of it. Just think of Christ's words in Revelation 2, verse 9, how He said to the church in Smyrna, I know your tribulation. And so He says to you this morning, I know your suffering. I know where you hurt. I see your tears. I hear your cries. I know what you've lost. I know the burdens you're under. I know the responsibilities upon your shoulders. And this is such a great comfort. It's no small comfort when a friend says to us, I know what you're going through. Even if they can't help us by any means whatsoever. Even if they can't do a single thing to relieve us, it comforts us just to know that someone knows. That we're not alone. That someone's listening. That someone gets it. Well, how much more when the one who says these words to us, I know your tribulation, is not an impotent man, but the Almighty, omnipotent God. He knows what you're going through, and He is not a God far off. He is a God who dwells with His people, a God who knows us, a God who knows what we're going through, and a God who walks with us through it all. Where was God when the three children were in the fiery furnace? But with them. Where was God when Daniel was in the lion's den? With them. Where was God when the family of eight was in the ark? With them. Where was God when His people were in Egypt? With them. Where is God right now? He's with you. Right where you are. God knows. And maybe you're wondering, well, how can God's knowing help? Well, look at the end of Exodus chapter 2, and you'll see that it's God's knowing His people suffering that ultimately leads to God delivering His people from it. We read there, the people of Israel groaned because of their slavery, and they cried out for help. Their cry for rescue from slavery came up to God, and God heard their groaning, and God remembered His covenant with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. God saw the people of Israel, and then it says, and God knew. You know what happens next in the passage? In Exodus chapter 3? God calls Moses and says, go deliver my people. See, God's knowing leads to His people's deliverance. In His time and manner, yes. But be thankful for the wisdom of God that directs these things, because He knows better than we do when and what we need. Thirdly, this morning, you have no reason to be discouraged today, because whatever your condition, God has made provisions for you not to be discouraged. What do you think all of the promises in Holy Scripture are? They're fortifications against your discouragement. They're heavenly cordials full of sweetness for your hearts and minds to ward off all discouragement. Cordials on nearly every page of Scripture that God would have you resort to in just such days as these. Look for yourself and you'll see it. For every promise given in Scripture to the prosperous, you'll find dozens more given to the afflicted. For every promise given for mornings of joy, you'll find hundreds given for nights of suffering. Scripture is flooded with promises of comfort, help, and relief suitable to every suffering condition. William Bridge challenged his congregation in the 17th century to show him any one condition for which God hadn't provided a promise of comfort and mercy. And I could level the same challenge to you today, and you'd be just as silent as his congregation was. Because we have God's own word on it in 2 Corinthians 1 verse 3. When Paul praises God for his panacea of promises, when he says, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies, the God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our affliction. Name any trouble. Name it. You've got to put it in that basket. All our affliction. So you have no reason to be discouraged, because God's provided against your discouragement by all His precious promises. And they're there in Scripture for you to take up by faith to your incomparable encouragement and joy. Use the promises and live by them. Fourthly, this morning, you have no reason to be discouraged, because whatever your condition, there are more reasons to be encouraged by it than there are to be discouraged by it. Now, that may sound strange, but hear me out. Do you realize that God comes near to you with more grace in suffering times than He does in prosperous times? John the Apostle, we read that he lay in the bosom of Christ, speaks of a very close and intimate relationship between Christ and John, this brotherly affection and love, this endearing relationship. So John lay in his bosom. It was a beautiful picture. Well, he lay in that bosom, we might say, for the years that they had together. And yet John never saw anything like the visions he saw and recorded for us in the book of Revelation. Do you remember when God came to John with those magnificent and glorious eschatological visions? It was when John was in exile on the Isle of Patmos. Think of Jacob. When was Jacob blessed to see the ladder let down from heaven, which Christ said was a vision of himself? When was Jacob privileged to see such a vision of Christ? Well, it was in Genesis 28, when Jacob was running for his life from his brother's wrath. Or when did Jacob see the Lord face to face and wrestle with God? Well, it was in Genesis 32, when he was running from the wrath of his uncle Laban and was afraid still of Esau. Do you see what this means? God never draws near to us with more encouragement than when we're most tempted to discouragement. You see, our sorest afflictions are prime seasons for his sweetest comforts. So we can encourage ourselves that if God has brought us into a suffering condition, then he is most certainly on his way with encouragement proportional to it. In fact, we'll find him more heavy laden with gifts and graces than normal, because he knows that we're more in need of it than normal. So if you're in a suffering season right now, and are we not all in a suffering season? Then let us endure with expectation and anticipation, because it only means that God is soon to come with the encouragements that we need. Indeed, in the very midst of our discouragements, he gives encouragements. Furthermore, this morning, you have no reason to be discouraged, because whatever your condition, in God's economy, discouragements bring encouragements. And this should be no surprise after what we just said. But think about it this way. Look in all the scriptures, and you'll be forced to say that this is simply God's way. In God's economy, it's the bitter that gives way to the sweet. It's hardship that leads to strength. It's loss that leads to gain. It's death that leads to life. It's the cross that leads to the crown. It's the suffering that leads to glory. Try and turn those on their heads, and you'll only double your trouble. Try and come by the ladder without the former, and you'll lose everything. Because this is simply God's way. You see, God takes the same way with each of us that he took with our head, the Lord Jesus Christ, for whom the cross preceded the crown, and suffering preceded glory. There's simply no way around it. And instead, we can glory in it, because we have now this confidence that whatever our discouragements, God has promised to use them to work our encouragements, so that we can glory, Paul says, in suffering. We can rejoice in sorrow. We can trust God with both the event and its outcome, which is how Paul can say what he says in 2 Corinthians 4, verses 16 and 17. He says, so we do not lose heart. Though our outer self is wasting away, our inner self is being renewed day by day. For this light, momentary affliction is preparing for us an eternal weight of glory beyond all comparison. Paul is saying, this is the way. This is God's way. This is the way to glory. This is the way to exaltation. This is the way to God's provision. This is the way to grace. The Lord ministers to us, and therefore we don't lose heart. That's why we read those words in Hosea chapter 2, verses 14 and 15. It says, behold, I will bring her, Israel, I will bring her into the wilderness and speak tenderly to her. And there I will give her her vineyards, and I will make the valley of Achor, which is trouble, the valley of trouble, I will make a door of hope. God uses our valleys of trouble as the very doors through which to bring us into our vineyards of joy. That's what the verse means. That's what it's saying. Israel was in a difficult strait, and God said, I'm going to bring her into a door of hope through this valley of trouble. I'm going to restore her vineyards in that wilderness. That's where I'm going to speak tenderly to her. So that just as the wilderness was Israel's doorway to the promised land, flowing with milk and honey, so our troubles will prove to be the doorway to our greatest comforts and our strongest graces. So we've got no reason to be discouraged, because discouragements in God's economy bring encouragements. They become the very doorway to encouragements, the very seasons for the greatest of blessings. Furthermore, number six this morning, you have no reason to be discouraged today. Because whatever your condition, you have the ear of God. I see our troubles may take a lot of things away from us. They might take our health, our job, our conveniences, our home, our loved ones, our very lives. But they can't take away our God. And having a God who cares for us, we have a God to whom we can pray and pour out our hearts in all honesty without fear. And beloved, this is no small mercy to have the ear of God. Indeed, William Bridge says it this way, it's a mercy to pray, even if we don't ever get the mercy prayed for. What a privilege to pray. What a blessing to utilize this means of grace. Because we can pray with such confidence, knowing that if we prayed for according to God's will, then we shall receive what we've asked. And if we failed to pray according to God's will, and our prayers were hindered by selfishness and our idolatrous request, we, for Christ's sake, will receive the things that we should have prayed for. Because Christ intercedes perfectly and without fail for us, as does His Spirit. It's a mercy to pray. And all of us who know the access we have to God's heart through prayer, and all of us who know the ways in which God uses prayer to pour His consolations into our own hearts, we know the strength of this truth. No condition need discourage us as long as we have the ear of God. Because whatever our condition, we can always say with David in Psalm 18, verse 6, in my distress I called upon the Lord. To my God I cried for help. From His temple He heard my voice, and my cry came to Him and reached His ears. And then he adds to it Psalm 40, verses 1 to 4. I waited patiently for the Lord. He inclined to me and heard my cry. He drew me up from the pit of destruction, out of the miry bog, and He set my feet upon a rock, making my steps secure. He put a new song in my mouth, a song of praise to our God. Many will see and hear and put their trust in the Lord. For blessed is the man who makes the Lord his trust. Blessed is the man who prays to God. Blessed is the man who has the ear of God. Number seven this morning, you have no reason to be discouraged, because whatever your condition, it's a cloud that'll soon pass over. We've already noted that God's people do and will come into dark places. Psalm 42 and 43. We will meet with storms on the way. We will face trying times. But because God works all things together for our good, and because God has united us with the one who rose after He died and who ascended to glory after His days of humiliation were finished, it cannot but be that all our suffering conditions are nothing more than passing clouds. Because whatever our darkness, it's the darkness of night and not of hell, which means the morning will come. It's the darkness of discipline and not judgment, which means it'll yield to us the peaceful fruit of righteousness. We may be on a vast ocean of untold storms right now. That may describe your life perfectly. But we will strike land again. You will reach shore yet. If it were the ocean of unending wrath, then there'd be no hope. But like our world's vast oceans, however big and wide they are, however unfathomably deep they are, brothers and sisters, all our oceans have a shore. All our oceans have a bottom. And so it is with all our troubles. They all have a time limit. They all have an end. They all must give way to the security, the peace, and the joy of the freedom and the salvation that we have in Jesus Christ. They may shake us. They may strip us. They may even leave us for dead. But all our troubles still know the voice of Him who said, "Peace, be still." And sooner or later, they'll all let go, and we'll find ourselves on the shores of our paradise in glory in the presence of Christ. So whatever your condition today, beloved, take heart. It is a cloud that will soon pass over and let the sun shine again. It is a mere trouble that must soon loose its grip and let you go. So that as the apostle said in Romans 13:11, our salvation is nearer to us now than when we first believed. Don't lose hope, beloved. Now, if we take these seven truths together, as we should, then we have to admit that there is no good reason to be discouraged today, whatever our condition may be. Each one of these points is enough to reprove us for any discouragement we may be feeling. And if you put all of them together, well, enough said. But you and I both know what a great struggle we have in actual practice. How often are these things good theory, but difficult practice? And we have a hard time to actually be encouraged, even when we have such good reasons for it. So if I have filled your hearts and minds with seven truths to fortify you against discouragement, seven truths upon which you need to exercise your faith today and tomorrow and the next, then give me a few more minutes to add five directions to it to help guide your faith into those very channels. I've told you what you need to believe and what you need to trust. Now let me encourage you how to do just that, that you might lay hold of these things. Let me motivate. Indeed, let me energize your faith and set it in these directions. First of all, to keep you from being discouraged, see that you never seek your comforts in or fix your heart upon any condition. That is, upon any temporal providence. Because conditions go out and come in like the tide. They change from one day to the next. Just look at where we are today compared to where we were only a few weeks ago. 5 weeks ago, we were sitting in church together sharing the Lord's Supper. 4 weeks ago, we were sitting in church together and welcomed four new members into our fellowship, and I preached a sermon encouraging and charging you to love one another, not in word only, but in deed and in truth. What a great encouragement that so many of you are doing that. You see the point here, don't you? Conditions cannot be trusted. Every condition in life, says William Bridge, it's like a rotten peg. And whatever you hang on it, that peg's going to break. So if you put your heart in your condition, you're just building on the sand. And we all know what happens to those castles. So why would you want to look for the heart's joys and the soul's comforts in a changeable condition? Better instead to fix your hearts on God. Better instead to seek your comforts in the unchangeable, immutable one. The one who is steadfast and who endures forever. Because as Isaiah 26 verse 4 says, the Lord is an everlasting rock. Think of a mighty rock protruding out of the ocean. The waves crash, the winds blow, but that rock is steadfast and stable. What a refuge. That's the picture here. Which is why God is able to keep him in perfect peace, whose mind and heart and hopes are all stayed on God. Secondly, to keep you from being discouraged, be sure that you look on Christ in relation to your condition. And by this I simply mean that just as there is no trouble that you can be in, but God has given you a promise of comfort for it, so there is no trouble you could be in, but God has given you an attribute in Christ to meet it. Consider, are you being accused by Satan or your own conscience? Christ is your advocate. Are you ignorant? Christ is your prophet. Are you guilty? Christ is your high priest. Are you being buffeted by the powerful armies of darkness and temptation? Christ is your king. Are you lost? Christ is your way to the Father. Are you hungry or thirsty for righteousness? Christ is your bread of life. Are you walking in darkness? Christ is your light. Are you afraid of being condemned by God? Christ is your righteousness. And on we can go. For every trouble, you have a Savior. And I hope you see what this means. It means that the way to guard against discouragement is to never look at your trouble, but you also look at Christ in relation to it. It's sort of like when a woman gets married. We never think of her alone again. Instead, we always think of her with her husband because marriage has joined the two together and made them one. We never think of her apart from her husband. Well, so it is with our troubles. By putting the fullness of our salvation in Christ, God has tied Christ to your troubles so that we are never to look on our troubles outside of Christ, because that's only discouraging. And we're never to look on Christ apart from our troubles, because that's presumptuous. Instead, we're to look on both together. And that keeps us from discouragement, no matter what our trouble is. Because for every suffering condition, God's given a promise. And for every trouble, God's given a Savior. God meets every single need. I have no reason to be discouraged. Thirdly, this morning, to keep you from being discouraged, be sure that you don't fret over your condition. Because according to Matthew 6, all it does is make it worse. Worrying and fretting makes every cross heavier. It makes every trial longer. It makes every sorrow more bitter. Every grief more painful. It's like a bird in the net. The more it strives to get out, the more entangled it gets. In fact, you can take this down as a golden rule. The way to have an affliction removed is to be content that it should stay. You see, if you're determined to throw off a trouble, if you're determined to be done with a bad providence, if you're determined to be done with a painful, difficult, trying providence, if you're determined to throw off a condition, all you do is prolong it. But if you're content before God to carry that cross as long as He would have you, then you can be sure it's about to be lifted. Because that contentment is an indication that the cross has done the work that it came to do. You've been transformed. You've grown in grace. You're humbled. You're content. You've learned to be content in every condition and situation, to be high, to be low, to have an abundance, to have a lack. The cross has done its work, and God will soon lift it. So a sure way to not be discouraged in your present wilderness is to be willing to wander in that wilderness as long as the Lord sees fit. Fourthly, to keep you from being discouraged, be sure you call things as God calls them. You see, one of the ways that Satan troubles us is by getting us to call things as he calls them. So that when things turn upside down in our life, we call it a disaster. When we meet with disappointment in life, we call it a royal mess. When something gets taken away from us, we say we don't deserve to be treated that way. When we lose something that we have found comfort in, we say we've been utterly ruined. When we fall down flat on our face, we say, there's no coming back from this. I'll never be the same. I'll never recover. My life is ruined. Because you see, those are the ways that Satan wants us to see those things. Because once we see our troubles that way, well, we can easily begin to find justification for such things as anger, complaining, murmuring, and despair. We say things to people, I have a right to be angry. I have a right to be upset. If you were in my shoes, you would know I have a right to complain. I have a right to give up hope. And all of these things only multiply our discouragements, which again separates us from the comforts we have in Christ, from the provisions that we can enjoy, from the water of life to drink for our soul's comfort. But what does God say about the same things? Well, God calls our afflictions fatherly disciplines. He calls our trials sanctifying blessings. He calls our sufferings purging furnaces. He calls our losses gains. He calls our crosses helps. Why, he even calls our death sleep. And he calls the day of judgment the day of our redemption. So the way to avoid discouragement in any condition is simply to call it what God calls it. In other words, think his thoughts after him. Speak his words after him. Say what God says. Isn't this what the psalmist is doing? What happens when you do that? Well, it will encourage you. Whereas calling things what Satan calls them discourages you, calling things what God calls them encourages you, because it encourages you to exercise faith and hope and love, because God says this is good for me. God says this is going to purge me of the things that need to go anyway. God says this is going to make me more like Christ. God says this is going to conform me to Jesus. God says I'm going to draw nearer to him through this. God says this is going to get rid of those idols in my heart. God says this is going to humble me and get rid of my pride. See, it encourages you to be patient. It encourages you to wait upon the Lord. It encourages you to look to the hills from whence your help comes. It encourages you to trust in the Lord and to rely on your God. When we call things what Satan calls them and we're discouraged, where do we go for help? Well, we look inside, don't we? We look to our own resolves. We look to our own strength. We look to our own resources. Or maybe we look to others. There's only way to look. The only place to look is to God. And we do that when we call things as God calls them. So that however bitter and sour and painful your suffering is, there is a way to draw sweetness and comfort out of your wilderness. If you'll look on it and Christ together, and if we just call it what God calls it. Satan calls it a valley of trouble. God calls it a door of hope. Satan says you're in a lost wilderness all alone. God says, I'll speak tenderly to you there. The scripture is full of it. See things as God sees them. Call them as he calls them. And that'll keep you from discouragement. And finally this morning, to keep you from being discouraged, be sure that you die to self. You see, if you take a closer look at it, you'll see that most often the real reason your suffering is so painful is not because the suffering itself is so painful, but because you're having a hard time not having things go your own way. And I know that's painful to even think about, but it is true. It's true for all of us. Because you see, if we could just put our whole selves into God's hands, and if we could just let him do with us what he knows best, and to give us what we need when he knows we need it, we would be so much happier. We would be so much more content. We'd be so much more trusting. But instead, we get our hearts set on a certain thing, on things going a certain way. And when we don't get our way, that's what causes us the pain. That's the grain that's being cut across. It's the grain of our own desires. The grain of our will for our lives. The grain of our selfishness. So we need to die to self. And we need to surrender ourselves to God and let him do with us what he will. And we'll be a whole lot happier whatever happens. Because the reference point for what's right and what's good will no longer be our selfish selves. Instead, the reference point for what is right and what is good will be the God and Father of the one who loved you, who died to save you, who rose to set you free, and now reigns to bless you and fill your hearts with joy unspeakable, regardless of your circumstances. You see the point here? God doesn't need your circumstances to be good in order to pour blessings into your life. God doesn't need a sunny day in order to come near to you with his presence and all of his graces. God can meet you on a rainy day. God can meet you in the midst of a storm. God can meet you when you've lost everything and you've got nothing left. And indeed, that's when God comes most near, as we've said. That's when he comes most heavy laden with blessings. Because not only are you now in the most need, but you're also most prepared to receive it. You see, when we have other things to rest on, we'll rest on them. When we have other things to trust in, hope in, we'll trust and hope in them. When we have a recourse that's more to our liking, we'll use it. The Lord comes to us in those seasons because it's in those seasons that we learn to die to self. So this morning, Let me say it again. As long as our reference point for what's right and what's good is either ourselves or our condition, we will never, ever be happy. We'll never be content. Because we'll always be putting our heart in places other than where we find ourselves. But let God be the reference point for what's right and good. Let God say, this is right. Let God say, this is good. And let us echo that. And joy will flood our soul in every condition. This is what Paul says from prison in Philippians 4. I'm content. I've learned in the school of Christ, he says, to be content in every situation. For I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. When our strength is in Christ, when our joy comes from Christ, when our hope is in our Savior and not in our condition, then let the conditions change with the tide. We can still rejoice. And that's why Paul says to the Philippian church, rejoice. Again, I say, rejoice. Now, brothers and sisters, I know the longer this providence continues, the harder it's going to be to keep your head up. So I've given you all the tools you need this morning to fortify yourselves against Satan's temptations and to walk a path of proactive faith that cultivates encouragement. So I pray you'll use it. I pray you'll walk this path. And I pray that God will use you to help others walk this path. Because it will always be true in every condition that that man and that man alone is blessed who looks not to his condition for hope, but whose hope is in the Lord of his condition. Amen. Let's pray. O gracious and loving Father, God of all comfort, lover of our souls, Spirit of peace. O God, we call upon you and come to you again this morning, looking unto you that your word will be brought to our hearts. We pray that you would take this message that has gone forth for your people today, and you will use it in a mighty way to minister to their hearts. May my words be forgotten, O God, but may your word not only be remembered and be deeply planted in the hearts of your people to bring forth fruits of righteousness in their lives to your glory, but may your word, your promise, give your people hope today. May they take these words and may they preach to themselves with the psalmist, hope in God, for I shall yet praise him, my salvation, and my God. Lord, we find ourselves in a difficult place, a trying place, and we are tempted to let our heads droop, our hearts sink, our hopes fail. Keep us strong. Cause us to persevere, and may the endurance of your people and the perseverance of their faith and the strength of their hope, may it be a testimony to the world around us that Christ reigns, that our hope is alive, that we are still in the eyes and the hands and under the care of our good God. Please lift this providence when its work is done, when we receive the blessings for which you have sent it. Lift this providence and bring us together again, that we may assemble, that we may pray together, sing together, listen together, believe together, come together at the Lord's table, and join with one another as brethren in your house. This is our heart's desire. We desire, O Lord, to behold your face through the means of grace, and we thank you that even through this medium you have met us today. Bless us all and be with us until we meet again. In Jesus' name we pray.